Ladies and gentlemen, I found him. I want you to meet the baddest motherfucker in town.
Welcome back to Legacy Options. Cesar Espejo here. Thank you for taking the time to watch this video and spend some time with me going over some things. So this video, I was thinking about what I'm going to do for this video, and what I thought about was whatever industry you're in, if you're in the military, if you're a cop, if you're a doctor in the hospital, everybody has acronyms for everything. The DTA and the APC and the NTC. And most people don't know what the hell you're talking about unless you're in that industry. Well, options are the same too, because a lot of the terminology that you use when you're talking about options, you know, after a while you know what they are, but at first you don't. So I said, let me put a video together, kind of going over all the terminologies that I'm using when we're talking about options, okay? So we'll start off with the easy one, a call. If you think a stock is going up, you buy a call. If you think a stock is going down, you buy a put. That's how you would make those bets. Now, if you remember from the first and second video, I don't do either of that. I don't buy any puts or calls. I sell puts and calls. So obviously a call, if I was to sell a call, and let's say a stock is trading at 100, and I sell the 120 call, I don't want the stock to go above the 120. If I am selling a put and stock is trading at 100 and I sell the 80 put, then I don't want that stock to go below 80, okay? So that's kind of what we do with options and calls and puts. ITM, any platform that you use, if you ever see ITM, is usually not a good thing. So if you sell a put and the stock is trading at 100 and you sold the 80 put, and the stock continues to drop in value, and it goes past the 80 put that you sold, then right away, the screen will tell you ITM, in the money. So your stock is in the money, now you have to do something about it. You have to roll it, you know, you have to do something in order to mitigate that, manage that trade. Okay, so in the money, if it goes below your strike price of 80. If you sold a call, and let's say you sold the 120 call and the stock rises above 120, you'll be in the money also. ATM, we're not talking about automated teller machine, getting money, we're talking about at the money. That's what that means. So if a stock is trading at 100, the option that's at 100 is considered at the money. So at the money is right where the stock is trading at that moment. OTM. Out of the money. That's where my strategy focuses on, is out of the money puts and calls, mainly puts. So if a stock is trading at $100 and you sell something or I sell something at 80, that's considered out of the money. If you sell a call and the stock is trading at 100 and you sell the 120, then that's considered out of the money. Now the tricky thing about out of the money is that the further out of the money you sell a put, the less risky the trade is. So you, as the person selling, want to be as far out of the money as you could possibly be. However, you got to understand, the further out of the money you are, the less premium you'll receive. So the closer to the money you are, so as you get closer to 100 where the stock is trading, you're going to get more money and more money and more money. And that's the decision you have to make. It's a balance. You have to figure out what's worth the risk that you're taking, right? And you'll see people that have strategies that are considered out of the money. So let's say the stock is trading at 100 and you sell the 97 put. That's considered out of the money. However, that's really close to the money, if you ask me. And I think it's just stressful to have to worry about, you know, hey, did it go under it? It's just not as comfortable as selling something $20 out of the money. So that's why I prefer to be way out of the money and not have to deal with that at all, okay? So those are out of the money puts. All right, so the next one is vertical spread. So the main strategy that I use for trading is I use vertical spreads on out of the money puts. So I do vertical put spreads. Just to give you an example of what a vertical spread is, a vertical call spread would be stock is trading at 100, I sell the 120, and then I buy the 125. So in essence, stock's trading at 100, I sell the 120, and then I buy the 125 call. That's called the vertical call spread. If it's a vertical put spread, stock's trading at 100, I sell the 80, and then I buy the 175. And in essence, what it does is it protects your position to the upside and to the downside. So if it's a call, a vertical call spread, and you sold the 120 and bought the 125, and the stock does like Apple just did, right? Apple pretty much went up and just kept going up, kept going up, kept going up. So if you sold the vertical call spread and you sold the, even let's say you sold the 120, and it just kept going, it went beyond the 125, went to 150, your risk is limited to the $5 between the 120 call and the 125 that you bought. Okay, that's how that works. Same thing for the downside. If the stock's trading at 100, you sold the 80 and you bought the 75 and the stock kept going down and went below the 75 point, your risk is $5. So that's why people like using vertical spreads, because they protect the downside. It's a limited risk and a defined risk. So you have a defined risk. You know what your potential loss can be if it gets to that. When you sell a naked put or a naked call, you know, people will say, oh, you're picking up pennies in front of a steamroller. You really aren't, but mathematically, technically you are. So let's say you sell a call on a stock that's at 100. When you place the trade in your platform, it's gonna say possibility of loss infinite. I mean, mathematically that's correct, because the stock could go from 100 to infinite number. However, the reality is it will never go to infinity. We'd be dead before that happens. And if it's a put, they'll say, you know, the possibility of loss is the stock going to zero, which could happen. However, we're not trading stocks that that's gonna happen to. JP Morgan Chase, Goldman Sachs, you know, Amazon, Google, Boeing, they're not gonna go to zero. So that's not gonna happen. But people feel more comfortable sometimes trading vertical. I do both. Depending on the situation, it makes sense sometimes to do a naked call, a naked put. But for the most part, we do try to stick to vertical because of the defined risk that offers, okay? We sell premium, that's what we do. Selling premium is, I guess, the best example I could give. Insurance companies, like let's say a car insurance company. You own a Honda Accord 2020, you just bought it. You go to the insurance company and say, I want you to insure my vehicle in case something happens. The insurance company says, okay, for protecting your vehicle, we're gonna charge you $1,000. That's the premium. They take the premium and they hold on to it. Nothing happens to your car in that year, they keep your $1,000. If something does happen to your car, then they will be responsible for, you know, paying up. So in essence, if you think about it, the tallest buildings with the fanciest lobbies and the skyscrapers are all usually insurance companies that own them, that operate out of them. They're making a killing because they sell a million policies. I can't tell you the last time I ever filed a claim for a vehicle. And that's most people. Most people don't go around crashing their cars all the time. It happens, but that's just a small portion of what happens. So they're making a killing on selling premium. And we're gonna dip into that world. We're gonna be making money also selling premium. All right, so that's what selling premium is. When you sell premium, you get a credit. And when you buy a put or you buy a call as part of a debit spread, you'll pay a debit. So in a vertical spread, when you sell the call or sell the put, you're gonna get a credit. And then when you buy the call or buy the put, you're gonna get a debit. So as an example, so you see how you make the money, right? If you sell a call and they pay you $2, and then you buy a call and then you have to pay out of your pocket $1, you get $1 as credit. And that's what you put in your pocket. $1, 100 shares, $100. Two contracts, $200. So on and so forth. Same thing with the put. If you sold a put at 80 and they paid you $5, and then you bought one at 75 and they charged you $2, then you take $3 and you put it in your pocket. If you sold one contract, that's $300. If you sold two contracts, that's $600. And that's what, you know, the credit and the debit situation. You hear people say, oh, I got a credit of $3. That's what you're talking about. Strangles. So some stocks kind of trade in a range and they stick between a certain amount of numbers. So let's say there's a stock, usually like bonds do this. Bonds don't move very violently up or down, except for now. Like everything's going up now. So even like the TLT, which is the one I'm talking about, I usually trade that one because it usually stays between, right now it's staying between 136 and 140. So if you sell a call at 142, you sell a put at 134 and they give you $2 for the 136 and $2 for the 134. That's $4 credit you put in your pocket. If in the 30 days that pass, whatever you sold, whatever time frame you sold, that doesn't happen, you keep the $4 and you move on. So it's like a strangle. You're strangling the stock. You're saying you're not gonna move from this boundary and you make money. So that's another strategy kind of use a lot here and there. DTE, it's football season. I think we're gonna have like a Super Bowl, but we're not talking about defensive tight ends. We're talking about days to expiration. So if you ever see that, that's all it means. You sold the put 30 days out, 40 days out. 40 days out is the days to expiration. That's how many days you have till that contract that you sold expires. Football, okay? Expire worthless. This is like a smile to my face, expiring worthless. Because every time something expires worthless, you're making money. But that's only if you're selling options. If you're buying options, then you're not happy when they're expired worthless. And in the first video, I talked about between 70 to 90% of all options expire worthless. So I've done research and I've seen that some people say 70 and other people say as much as 90% expire worthless. I'm of the opinion that it's about 80 plus percent expire worthless, just from trading options all the time and seeing what expires worthless. So this makes us happy and it makes people who buy them not happy. Remember, we want to be on the side of 80 to 90% of winning all the time. So that's why we sell options. If you're trading on Tastyworks, they use this system here, which is probability of profit, POP. So when you place a trade, it literally tells you immediately what your probability of profit is. So if it says 80, then that's an 80% probability of profit. 90, even 99% sometimes, depending on what you're doing. And they have probability of profit at 50%. So they've done their own research and studied. People way smarter than me sat down and kind of went through all the scenarios. And what they found is that if you were to sell a profitable position at 50%. So let's say you sold an option and you got $200. Once you hit $100, get out of it. That in the long run, you're gonna be more profitable than if you kept the position to expiration. That's, I agree with it in some point, but for the most part, I don't do that all the time. You know, if a position is way out of the money and I've held it already for 25 days and there's only 5 days left, I'm gonna wait till I get the full amount and let it expire worthless. However, if I sell something and let's say I sell something 45 days to expiration and 5 days into it, the stock shoots up and I already made 70% of the profit, then I'm not gonna wait another 40 days to get 30%. So I would get rid of it right away. So I think it's just better just to weigh your options and see if that's something you want to do or don't want to do. Sometimes it makes sense, sometimes it doesn't. That's my opinion. These two things here are very important. Implied volatility and the VIX. So implied volatility is what the market thinks is going to, the volatility of whatever option it is. So certain options or stocks have a higher implied volatility. And those are the ones that give you more premium. So those are the ones you're gonna wanna look at sometimes to trade, as opposed to something with very low implied volatility. So an example of this would be Tesla usually has a high implied volatility. Why? Because it's a very volatile stock. It could go from 250 to 500 just like that. But if you look at a stock like, I don't know, let's pick something real stable, you know, Raytheon or JP Morgan Chase, you know, those, they have low implied volatility. Those stocks don't move, those companies don't move as fast as others. And then the VIX. So the VIX is considered the fear gauge of the market. So when the market is going like it's doing right now, it's just going up and up and up and up. The market is very complacent. Everybody is happy. Everything is great. If something happens, a tweet goes out, some type of trade situation, the jobs report, there's fears of recession, then the VIX increases. And what's interesting is that as options trader, we actually want, we want two-sided action. So we don't like it when it just goes up and up and up and up, because we're getting less premium for the positions that we're selling. And because of that, I am holding back on what I'm doing, because when volatility is low, implied volatility is low, if I was to sell a contract, I might get, let's say, $1. And if the VIX, the implied volatility increases, that same position that I got $1 for, I could probably get $3 for tomorrow. So this is why we want to wait for volatility increase in order to start selling premium. There's more opportunities when there's volatility. We want and we like two-sided action. We want to see it go up and go down and go up and go down. We just don't want it to go up and up and up and up, because that doesn't help us make money selling premium. So that's important to know. ES&P minis. So I'm gonna say something that's maybe weird, but so everybody, when they talk about the market, they talk about the Dow Jones. The Dow Jones is up to 29,000, it's at 20,000, whatever it is. I think they've done a great job of marketing, I guess, because the Dow Jones is actually considered, in my opinion, I think it's maybe more popular than the S&P 500. When in actuality, it shouldn't be. It doesn't show that great a picture of the economy itself. So if you think about it, there's 30 stocks in the Dow Jones. So 30 stocks, that's really not a large representative number of our economy. The S&P 500 has 500 companies, largest and biggest companies in America. And then you got the Russell 2000, which is a smaller cap US companies also. But some of the same companies are shared by the indexes. So the Dow has the same, some of the same companies as the S&P 500 does. So you'll have Apple on both sides, you'll have Google. And what's kind of tricky right now, and people should be paying attention to this, I don't know how many people are, but these large cap companies that are actually worth $1 trillion. I mean, $1 trillion. A company's worth $1 trillion. A couple of them are right now. I think Apple just hit that mark. Google just hit that mark. $2 trillion. So as these companies are going up, both indexes are rising to all new records. I mean, it's a record after record after record every single day. But I think it's those companies raising these indexes up, as opposed to all the other companies, which are probably doing good, but maybe not that great. So it's something to keep in mind as you're looking at these markets, go up, go up, go up. And everything that goes up usually comes back down, and nothing goes up 40% in 2-3 months and just continues to do that. So be aware, and that's why I'm being very patient, very risk averse on any position that I'm putting out right now, because risk of it going down is there. Even though the market doesn't seem to think that, so I'm really wrong. So the ES&P minis represents S&P 500, which this is a futures contract, but they have an index called the SPX, which tracks the S&P 500 exactly how it is, and then they have the SPY, which is 10% of the SPX. So if the S&P 500 is trading at 3,300, the SPX is trading at 3,300. The SPY would be trading at 10% of that, so 330. So if your account is this big, you go with SPY. If your account is really big, then you go with SPX. And once you learn futures, you realize you don't even need that much money to protect your entire account. And that will cover, with a futures e-mini account, e-mini contract, you could cover your whole account, trade it in and out a lot cheaper, way more efficient. When we talk about underlying stock, all we're just saying is, and this is the underlying, we're talking about Amazon options, we're just talking about the underlying is Amazon. It's just the stock. So sometimes you say it and people might think, what are they talking about? That's what it is. I talked about naked selling and covered selling. So covered selling is, let's say you have 1,000 shares of Disney. You inherited it, your grandma gave it to you, your grandpa gave it to you as a gift. You have these 1,000 shares and you want to start making some money off of your 1,000 shares besides the dividend that it gives you. You can sell a call. So if you have 1,000 shares, you can sell 10 contracts 30 days out and they'll pay you. But it's covered because if you said that this stock won't go above 125 and it shoots up to 150, all they will do is just call away the shares that you already own. So it's a covered position. The broker says he's good to go. It doesn't cost him anything to do. It's almost like a free trade, except for the fees associated with the position that you place. All right, so that covers kind of all the basic stuff that we're gonna talk about. But I have something that I wanted to share that I'm gonna be doing soon. And I'm gonna call this, because I thought about it, I'm like, man, how could I add more value to my channel, to everybody who's watching, everybody's taking the time to sit here and go through this process and wants to learn. So hopefully you already know why you wanna do this. You've set some money aside to do it. You've opened an account. Well, now the next step is to put on trades, and then you're gonna say, well, what should I put on? Well, I wanna give you at least one trade that I do a week, and I'm gonna go through the parameters of why I put that trade on, how much it costs, how much they paid me, and go through the process. That way I could share with you and you could learn with me what happens when you put on a trade. I'm gonna call that the weekly trade, and I'm gonna start that the next video I do. And that's it. Once again, thank you very much. Like I always say, health, wealth, and love. Peace.